Now on One, we profile one of Ireland's most successful sporting talents. Aidan O'Brien is known to many as the young prince of Ballydoyle.
In front, here's High Chaparral on the outside.
Aidan, he only knows one way to do it, and that's the right way.
Two furlongs left to go in the derby.
He's got there from being successful before he ever began to train for Coolmore.
The two Aidan O'Brien runners settle down to fight it out.
For a man so young, and what he's achieved is beyond, is before his time.
Hawkwing is trying with every stride.
He's got an old head on young shoulders.
It's High Chaparral by two.
I think he's able to get the best out of people around him without too much effort.
Goes on to win the Vodafone Derby.
Ballydoyle was created in 1951 by Vincent O'Brien. It's now renowned throughout the racing industry as one of the finest training establishments in the world. With the backing and support of Coolmore Stud, arguably the most powerful breeding empire ever seen, Aidan O'Brien picked up the reins at Ballydoyle and with every passing year has contrived to rewrite the record books. This partnership has become the greatest equine team in the world.
Only a small number of men have become international figures through horse racing. Vincent O'Brien is one of them. He may look like a quiet country doctor, but that shy exterior shields a dynamism that has produced horses to win every big race in Ireland or England, including three Cheltenham Gold Cups, three Champion Hurdles, and three Grand Nationals. Every one of the classics, he's won the Epsom Derby four times, as well as the Prix de l'Arc de Triomphe and the Washington International. O'Brien, the quiet master of Ballydoyle, has in all these years handled some of the greatest racehorses the world has ever known.
I would hate to differentiate between these great horses I've been so fortunate to have. I really would. And as for the moments, I've had great moments, and again, I would hate to say there was one which was the greatest.
Well, you got a little bit blasé about everything because it was all I was ever used to. I was dragged to the races from the time I could walk. When you were in the midst of it, the whole time, it was hard to be objective about it. It was just accepted as a normal practice that they won everything. To look back on it now, I mean, it is an incredible achievement what he achieved in Ballydoyle and in Cork beforehand when he was principally a national hunt trainer.
It's quite ironic, isn't it, that they both have the surname O'Brien, and a lot of people who don't have that much knowledge of racing obviously assume that there is a relationship there, that they're related to each other, but there's absolutely no connection family-wise between Vincent O'Brien and Aidan O'Brien, but they do train from the same place. I was very, very small when I was first brought over to Ireland. I think I was six, and I really believed in leprechauns. I remember I'd been read all these marvellous stories about Ireland and the leprechauns, and I kept looking for them everywhere. And I remember one of the lads in the yard at Ballydoyle was telling me that they were in the straw and that the horses could see them and we couldn't see them. And I remember being driven down the long driveway to Ballydoyle and meeting Vincent and watching Daddy ride a piece of work. I think it was actually probably Nijinsky at the time. I just remember it being huge and a great atmosphere, you know, real serious atmosphere of sort of triumph, and it was just a lovely introduction to Ireland because that was the first time I ever came here. I remember seeing my father one day going into a horse's box that nobody else could go near. The horse was very, very wild and very hard to get close to, and when my father went into the box, the horse completely changed. He dropped his head and he became very easy, very manageable, and it seemed to be something that my father was able to connect to with a horse. I've seen Vincent O'Brien being able to do that in a very similar way, and also Aidan, and I think that they both have this special gift, without wanting to sound like Dr. Doolittle talking to the animals, but I do believe that they have something that is very rare and unique that very few people have, but horses can pick up on it and they act differently with them than other people. Like with a lot of great, great talents, great sports people, great geniuses in any walk of life, they do not know how they do what they do. But I think the similarities were that they had an amazing attention to detail, and they're both very quiet-spoken people. You can actually almost see them being able to get into a horse's mind, and I think that's what made them extra special and brilliant, brilliant trainers.
From the time he was eight, Dennis,
yeah,
he was jumping ponies and pony clubbing and all those things. He really got plenty of enjoyment out of it.
He was always very quiet, but what he was at, he always worked at. It's no different what he was doing, he could get on with it. Oh, we gave him plenty of encouragement. because I often put him on ponies that he would be able to ride, and still he'd get up and go again. Well, I won 140 pound of pints, but I never won a race under the roads. I was trained a few, all right, but never won one. But I never had horses good enough to win. You know, I hadn't breeding. There were only Midland bred horses. Well, the first thing, he bought a little turbid mare, but she was terrible contrary. Then he sold that one, and then he got into PJ Finn's after that. And he stayed there for a year, I think. Then he went going to Jim Budger's. That was his aim, to get into Jim's.
And he knew by getting into Jim Budger's, he'd, you know, he'd be dealing with good horses. And he had, you know, he looked up a lot to Jim Budger and the way he trained. And
Jim was a hard master, but he was very fair.
He was very, very keen to be there.
Multiple Irish champion trainer Jim Bulger was Aidan's mentor for 3.5 years. Under his tutelage, Aidan won the Irish champion amateur jockey title.
It was very pleasant when he was here. He was a tremendous worker, always very reliable. He had a mind like a sponge. Everything you told him or he asked about seemed to be absorbed and didn't have to be asked a second time. And generally, I suppose, I'd remember him as a very pleasant young man to work with.
Galacto Boy is going further in front, is now 15 up on Celtic Chieftain, Arctic Flair and Woodbrook Boy.
First winner at Punchestown, He's he won a bumper, I think, won very easy.
To race, Galacto Boy remains over 12-15 in front.
I think it's great for anybody, a trainer, jockey, lad, a work rider, anything, everybody that's involved gets a big kick when a horse wins. Obviously there's a very small distance between winning and losing sometimes, and obviously it's very important that they win.
The winning post coming in plenty of time for Galacto Boy to hold off Arctic Flair.
It just really depends on the way it falls on the day.
In late 1991, Aidan married Ireland's then champion trainer, Anne-Marie Crowley.
Anne-Marie is wonderful, really, you know. I mean, she's absolutely on the same wavelength as he is himself. Yeah. And they're a good team. Anne-Marie is really wonderful.
Anne-Marie was champion trainer that year. And when we got married then, Anne-Marie just decided that the license would be probably better in my name when we had the little ones and that.
Yes, Anne-Marie had a good bit of experience, both as a rider and as a, she saw some breeding operation here as well. And of course Aidan was with Jim Bulger and with a few top trainers before he came here. He had natural ability as well. He was able to make use of all the opportunity he got.
But it's wandering towards Windsor's down, close for the placing.
Few, if any, have had a bigger influence on the world of horse racing than John Magner of Coolmore Stud. A son-in-law of Vincent O'Brien, nobody is better placed to offer an insight into the two O'Briens.
I'd say that the common denominator between the two is that they're two very talented people. So I would say it's how similar they are, really, rather than how different they are. That's just the way I see it. How he came to my notice was that I just read about all the success he was having. And then Christy Roach mentioned to me one day how good he thought he was.
If he hadn't been going that well, it would have been an easy enough decision, but it was a rather difficult decision for him to make. But I think he always liked to train a top flat horse, and that was probably the deciding factor.
It was never going to take very long. People said Aidan O'Brien couldn't train a winner in England. How many seasons training you in? Two seasons? Three seasons?
This is our fourth.
Fourth season. Well, we've been looking at your statistics. We just can't understand it. We think there can't be any other trainers in Ireland. But what's the secret of what's going on out there?
I don't know. Good horse is a good staff, I suppose. And
don't tell him.
Yeah.
Don't tell him.
So obviously it was a great place. We were honoured to be asked to come here, and we knew that Dr. O'Brien trained all the great horses here, and we were looking forward to coming.
Undoubtedly, Vincent O'Brien and Lester Piggott's recognition of each other's unique talents contributed to their success, and Ballydoyle stable jockey Michael Canaan knows more than most the value of talent spotting.
Well, I'd say it was initially John Magner's attraction towards Aidan O'Brien, and their future plans were trying to get Coolmore back on, Ballydoyle back on the road again. And at that time, Aidan was making a huge impression in the National Hunt and Flat, meteoric rise, and he probably wanted to find out more about this man, and
he's found out a fair bit now.
Aidan does all the planning, really. He talks to everybody. Occasionally, Michael would come over and run through the horses. There's plenty of dialogue between everybody, but ultimately, Aidan calls the shots.
Well, he loves what he's doing, but I think if you haven't natural ability, you could work as hard as you like. If you weren't able to spot something wrong with a horse or able to place him properly or able to do the right things with him, you need a bit of luck, obviously, but I think he has exceptional ability.
Oh, yeah, I think he's very special. Like, I know he's training a very high-class thoroughbred, but you got to know what you're looking at. Like, they've assembled a marvellous array of horsemen, each with his own piece to put to the puzzle, and people are allowed to flourish around John Magner. He's not jealous of that, and I think he motivates people to work and to perform.
You must remember in Ireland that the other trainers that are high up on the table, you see somebody like Dermot Weld, who's won the Melbourne Cup, he's already won an American Classic, you know, he's won a lot of things over a long time. John Ox with Sindal, Jim Bulger next on the list, who actually taught Aidan. So, like, Aidan isn't the only one in Ireland that can train a good horse. You know, the standard is very high, and plus there are a whole lot of young people coming on now, and I think the future is very bright as regards talent in Ireland, and we're just lucky to have one of the good ones.
Nice spread of 3-year-old,
yes. The way he maintained the horses this year through the season, like, we started them all very early and they never wavered once. To maintain them at that high level all through the season and not dip once was, I think that's where he's got to be measured on.
Yeah, the only thing is he has a lot of miles on the clock. He started early and, the days are long and he's always trained a lot of horses. So, you know, he's got an old head on young shoulders.
Yeah, I brought Aisling, my daughter, to St. Cloud, and I went to get changed and she went along with Aidan to the saddling area, and one of the horses played up a bit and Aidan just seemed to calm it down. But I was driving back with Aisling and after the races, and she said she couldn't believe that one of these horses just fizzed up, and he in 2 seconds had calmed her down. And but she was really gobsmacked. She thought she had seen somebody special work. Horses must feel relaxed around him and they definitely listen to what he has got to say, and it seems very unusual.
Yeah, Mick is a very professional person. He always knows what to do through a race, and sometimes races work out, sometimes they don't, and we know that when everybody does their best, that's all you can do, and whatever will be after B will be.
Yeah, we get along well, you know, it's an important, you got to be able to laugh at yourself too, and people mightn't think that sometimes, but we do.
Mick would have a great knowledge of all the horses, all of us, from riding against him, and he would have an idea of what's going to happen before the race usually.
I know once he legs me up and points me in the right direction, I have nothing to fear. I know they're as well prepared as possibly can, and I would think that he feels that once he legs me up, he's confident he has the right man to do the job.
Don't ever give him any instructions. Mick knows the horses and he knows what to do, and he decides when he's out there. Takes each race as it comes, each horse differently on the day.
I know Brian, who's had such a wonderful 3 days here at York, on his way down to the start, absolutely meticulous about the way his horses are prepared. Now you can't get out of the car much quicker than that unless the policeman's around. Not sure what he's doing, whether he just wants to make sure his horse is settled. I'd imagine that something's gone through his mind that he just remembered that he wanted to tell Michael Canal. I can't think that there's any other reason.
If he thought for 1 second that he hadn't put everything on the table to me and told me everything that in the pre-race plan, and he wouldn't stand still, you know, and most of the time I ride as Aidan would like it, and sometimes plan B or plan C has to come into action, and that's what I'm there for.
I suppose you would be a bit anxious before some of the races, but you do your best, and like, that's all you can do, and whatever will be.
He does get rather nervous and uptight in big days, but that's part and parcel of the man.
Thank you.
associated with some of the greatest flat horses in the world, Aidan was for years the guardian of a national icon, the charismatic Istabrak.
John Durkin, Lord of Mercy, and him rang me one night and said that he was after buying him at the sales and he was going off for treatment. And he asked me would we take care of him for a while until he was hoping that he'd be okay to train him the following season.
When he went to Ballydoyle first, I had two novices with Aidan at the time, Finnegan's Hollow and Istabrak, and Aidan kept telling me that Istabrak, you know, that he was very pleased with him, that he was going very well with Finnegan's Hollow. And, you know, I was a bit disappointed because I thought so much of Finnegan's Hollow, I didn't think there was a novice that could give him his fill of it. So rather than being elated with the news, I was actually disappointed when I heard it.
Yeah, obviously he is brilliantly bred by Saddlers Wells out of Betty's Secret, half-brother to us, a Derby winner. He's a great technique at jumping. He's a high cruising speed. He stays very well and he loves to win. And his mental state then, when you kick his mind into gear, it just makes him very different. He's able to pump more adrenaline through his body, I'd say, than any other national hunters I've ever seen.
We ran Istabrak in the Sun Alliance because we thought Finnegan's would be better suited to the 2 mile than Istabrak. Well, I suppose when anybody buys a jumping horse, their ambition is to win at Cheltenham. That's friendly rivalry, you know. I think the English admire a good horse just the same as the Irish, you know. And you've a great audience travel to Cheltenham and you've a great English audience there, and I think they admire what's best.
Before the race, he just got a little bit excited. He fretted a little bit. I think there was a false start and that got him more revved up. So Charlie dropped him right in and took his time on him. He slowly crept through the field and he was arriving there, I think, at the second last and got a very bad bump.
Here comes Istabrak, full of running. This is too hard. Oh, he was bumped there, Istabrak, but it's a battler. It's coming through on the inside of Forest Ivory. So they've just got one more flight of hurdles to jump.
But he got him back balanced and I think he took it up going to the last. There's no second to Charlie as a jockey. He knows him inside out and I don't think there's any doubt that he's a vital part of Istabrak.
You know, I don't think it was his plan the day beforehand or the week beforehand to ride him like that, but it worked out all for the best.
At the line, Istabrak wins for Ireland, Charlie Swan knows it.
He was very well up to the champion hurdle. Everyone was very confident with him, very confident about him at home, and he was very well. His training had went well, and we always thought that he had plenty of class and that he would get the trip well, and we felt that he was in good shape that day.
The Smurfit Champion Hurdle goes to the Irish on St Patrick's Day. It's Istabrak and Charlie Swan who win. It's going to be an Irish 1-2, not just an Irish 1-2, an Aidan O'Brien 1-2.
Istabrak was originally bought by John Durkin for owner J.P. McManus. John tragically died before he had a chance to realise his dream.
Charlie Swan, what a horse.
What a horse. Aidan O'Brien was right. He told me he destroyed him, and he did, you know. He's some trainer.
And a dream come true with all the connections and all the story behind this horse.
I mean, this is for John Durkin.
It's all right. Very well done, Charlie. Words can't say enough. Well done.
How emotional was this? Out of all the winners, all the money and all that, how emotional is this?
These are magic moments.
Always at the start of the year, JP would go through the campaign that he had planned out for him, and the way he would always say the way he would like him brought along, and the races that he would like him to run in. And from race to race, then JP would always know his weights and he'd always know how he's training. He'd have a picture in his own head where he's going. And through the year, usually he's physically fit, but mentally he's asleep. But when you wake him up mentally, he won't last too long because his mental state will self-destruct his body if you have it all together too quick.
Throughout the winter, Istabrak was prepared for his historic attempt at a third Cheltenham Champion Hurdle. But the most meticulous preparations were thrown into disarray when, on the eve of the race, Istabrak was ominously found to have blood in his nose. Aidan's skill and judgment would be tested like never before.
And obviously when a horse has blood in the nose, it's usually a disaster. It's usually curtains when it happens. So it was a big decision. We knew that he had been brought along slowly and we'd done everything we could, and we knew that he was well. We also felt that we couldn't deprive him of the chance of being one of the greats by not running him?
I don't know about other owners, but, you know, Aidan knows more about the situation than I or anybody else, and it wouldn't be right for me to interfere at that stage. And I knew he wouldn't run the horse if he didn't believe it was the right thing to do.
Vast applause going right round the stands for a hugely popular champion. Charlie Swan absolutely ecstatic, the crowd knowing they're seeing history. Istabrak lands the odds.
I think the decision was made with everybody, and you would nearly always know by JP what he would be thinking without him telling you. He would very rarely tell you anything, but you'd know by talking to him. Only for the horse was so good, and I think he just showed how good he was on the day.
This is the fourth time he's been here. He's Ireland's horse, and how they love him.
Years ago, Ireland had their best ever opening day at the festival. They won the first three races. Can they do it again? Well, the Euros are down for it. Istabrak is now in to 15-8. One bookmaker is going 2-1, but plenty of 7-4 against Istabrak.
Okay, I've come down to where the cheering will be going on in about 5 minutes' time. They've been here. These are the people. These are the race. Who's going to win?
Istabrak!
Everyone, who's not going for Istabrak?
Istabrak,
2-1 favourite. But if you think the worst could possibly happen for Istabrak, well, Irish bookmaker Paddy Power is going 8-1 against Istabrak not finishing. Now imagine if he's going badly, Charlie Swan won't persevere with the old warrior. 8-1, Istabrak not to complete the course.
When you own horses, you've got to run them, like, if they're well in themselves and the conditions are right. And there's always the danger that someday that you get some bad news.
Back as well. They turn left-handed, passing the stands, and it's Mr. Cool from Ansar. Then Rostropovich, a couple of lengths to Landing Light in a good position in fourth place. And Istabrak is tailing off, and he's being pulled up by Charlie Swan. Istabrak, the three times champion, being pulled up after just two flights of hurdles, and it may be that an honourable retirement awaits.
You don't often hear a horse pulled up favourite in the champion hurdle, and they applauded from the stands again.
I couldn't believe it. Very sporting people there, and you know, it's sad, but it's been fantastic, you know.
Well, they applaud you for the simple reason you've lit the place up, the two of you, for so many years. Thanks for that, and at least he's safe and sound.
Thanks.
Cheers, Charlie.
It's just one of those things that his clock didn't stop. Like, he was different than most National Hunt horses. He was in training from the time he was a yearling, and we had him, I think, for 6 years, and he was racing at the top level for those six, and he was working very hard day in, day out, 1 year after another. And there comes a time when they don't be as good and when little problems catch up on them. And I'd say he's the luckiest horse in the world to go back and retire in Martinstown. If I was a horse, I wouldn't want to retire anywhere else or be owned by anybody else.
I don't know if one gave me more than any of the others, but it was great to win the third, and it was great to win the first. So, and the second didn't feel too bad either.
I think he means the world to JP. I think he means more than any horse could ever mean to any human being. These horses don't ever come. Like, this lad is probably the greatest ever. When he is on song and when he's piping, there's... he'd be very hard to beat. But I think the man who owns him has made all the difference, the way he's handled him, taken him. He's treated him like a baby with kid gloves all the way from ever before he came here.
If Istabrak had lit up the racetrack, Aidan had now gone on to acquire an international reputation. The mantle of the great Vincent O'Brien was a perfect fit.
When I'm around that stable, obviously I can't help remembering times I spent there with Vincent O'Brien. Yeah, someone who's worked in sport for 40 years and longer than I care to remember. It's perhaps the only time in my life, with the possible exception of interviews with hanging around with Muhammad Ali, when I was talking to someone who was almost certainly the best who ever lived at what he did. You go back now, you feel that the atmosphere, the aura that surrounded Vincent still exists. You're dealing with people who may be in a billion-dollar complex of breeding and training and winning races, but always you know that they are excited by what they do, they're committed to it, and they bring excitement and fun to the race course. When Aidan was talking to me about Galileo, and he said, you can tell how he is by how he behaves. He said, the expression on his face, how he carries on with himself. He said, he's not shy, you know. And when you hear that in relation to a great horse, you know that the affinity that he has with the animal is something that communicates itself not only in performance, but, as I've said, in the fun and the excitement that those horses bring to us once they go on the race course.
With all the races and records that fell to Aidan since he started training, the one race that had eluded him was the blue riband of English racing, the Epsom Derby.
You know, from the very start of the time that Galileo went there, Aidan always thought he was a special horse, and throughout the build-up to the race, he was always very confident.
Like, the beauty of Galileo was he had great early tactical pace, and he always got in control of the situation very quickly. And he jumped beautifully at Epsom and got into a lovely position, and was so balanced coming down the hill. It was he was a joy to ride around there.
They set sail for the judge, rounding Tattenham Corner, straightening up, 3 furlongs to go in the Derby. Mr. Combustible set sail in front from Perfect Sunday. Here's Galileo now on the outside, moving up the foot, out the big challenge.
There's no fair he was going to win. It's hard to put into words how you feel. You just want to get up to that winning post and get the result, and then enjoy it afterwards, because it's you're never sure until you pass the winning post.
But it's Galileo, a half furlong left to go, and Galileo is going to career away with the Derby. Galileo goes on to win it.
This is another of the extra excitements that it gives to me, that I can talk to Aidan Bryan, I can talk to Michael Canaan and to John Magnan, to Michael Tabor and to JP, because I always think of him as being involved in that too. And you know that you're dealing with people who, as I always say, know the story.
Well, Michael Tabor has been saying, I just want to see it again. It was that impressive. We talked to you beforehand. My word, that horse is something special.
You look very special. As I say, I'd like to see the tape of it again, because I can't quite believe it. And it's just an incredible performance. He was.
I just think there's very few occasions where you see a thoroughbred racehorse that is most definitely at its peak. That was just fabulous. And the side shot we used, the wire cam shot, when you really saw him accelerate, I've had so many non-racing people say to me, they could really see the change of gear there and the speed he produced and how balanced he was compared to everything else in the race. And I just think Aidan O'Brien has been sensational all year. He's not a naturally confident, outgoing person, but in terms of the media, he's got better and better. He's managing to articulate his excitement and his understanding of racehorses, and that really helps, because you've got to sell the business to as many people as you possibly can, and they have to understand what he feels.
He obviously is in love with training racehorses, and you have to enjoy what you do in life, because if you enjoy it, it isn't like work. And when you get up in the morning and you think, hey, I've got to go to work, that's no good. You want to, when you get up, you can't wait to be there. And I suppose Aidan must be like that. I've never actually asked him, but I'm sure he just loves to be with his horses.
After the Derby, I couldn't see Aidan. And I was thinking, I've got to grab Aidan. So I said to John Magnan, where's Aidan? In this really completely panicky voice. He said, it's all right, Claire, he's by the horse. And I thought, yes, of course he is, how obvious. And it was a sensational 2 days for Aidan. And it's extraordinary to think that he hadn't won the Derby before, because one just imagines that he had done, but he really hasn't been around for very long. And, to do an Oaks Derby double, and the filly in the Oaks, Imagine, who didn't really handle the course. And as he said afterwards, just think how far she'd have won by if she had handled it. And Galileo was just sensational. I mean, it really was a wonderful, wonderful 2 days.
When you look back at the start of the season, I can remember sitting at Kempton, I think it was the Easter meeting, and we showed a couple of clips from some races from Leopardstown, and Aidan had a couple of cops beaten, and they looked like they were going up and down on the same spot, and people were saying, he's going to have a bad season. It's extraordinary when you just look back that little way.
Our horses were probably a bit behind when we started racing, and they all probably took 2 to 3 runs to get fit. They kept going through the year. They stayed healthy, I think, was the main thing.
I mean, it was just one after another, and it got to the stage later on in the season that you're really thinking, God, let's hope he goes through the clean, sweep with the 2-year-olds and, wins everything. But the main thing about it is he's the nicest guy to deal with. Of all the trainers we go and interview, have anything to do with it, he puts himself out more than anybody else.
Actually, all those group ones were all big days, obviously, and the classics were big days. We just take each day as it comes, and each horse as it comes, and each race as it comes, and just try to get the best out of each horse that we have.
Well, I suppose Galileo's wins now are very exciting.
Yeah, getting more exciting every day.
Every day. It's hard to pick them out, they're getting better.
With racing becoming ever more popular, the Aidan O'Brien team attracted a new player with one of the world's most famous football managers.
A 1-2-3 for O'Brien, but who's won it? It's very.
Regardless of the margin of victory in football or in racing, it's still about coming first.
I think you and Aidan are equal. No football tickets for you.
On the January of the first year that Issa Bright won the Champion Hurdle, that was about 4 years ago, we went to Ballydoyle for the first time to see Issa Bright. I couldn't believe the setup. You wouldn't think for a minute, when you go there, that this is the most successful business in the world, in the horse racing industry. Now this young man in charge of this empire, and how thorough and meticulous, he could have maybe 40 work jockeys every morning and recognising all their names. His observation, concentration, it's marvellous to watch him.
He loves his horses, he loves racing, he loves meeting the people at the races. And obviously he's great for the game, great knowledge of racing, and it's great to have him as an owner.
For a man so young, and what he's achieved is before his time. When I started at 32 years of age as a manager, I had a lot of the qualities I've seen Aidan. But I think I've improved over the years through experience. What the question you ask me today, and I ask myself, and people always ask, are you still hungry? They still want to get up at 5 in the morning, 6 in the morning, get the lot out for the first lot of training, have the second lot, the third lot. That is the key to it. If you ask me, no doubt in my mind about him. My decision making would be about picking a team for a particular game. Their decision making would be which horse they place in a race, which is equal importance in the sense of making sure you're right. So that is the same thing. and the preparation, making sure the horse is given the proper chance to win the race. We at this club, you see how I've built up this medical staff here, the coaches, this complex we've got now, the training fields, that's to give us the best preparation we possibly can to win a game of football. And that's the morality is there also.
With winning at Ballydoyle and Old Trafford being about meticulous preparation and giving yourself every chance to win, Sir Alex also sees similar attributes between great footballers and great horses.
Well, I've got a Van Nistelrooy and I've got a Solskjaer at Ballydoyle. Yeah, there's a horse named after Rudd and a horse after Ole Gunnar. They're very good horses. The joke was, when they named it after Ole, that they'll bring him on the last furlong.
We haven't got a horse tough enough to be named Roy Keane yet, I think.
As they run to the final furlong, Giant's Causeway is battling well.
The great horses they've had over the last 2 or 3 years, Giant's Causeway, Guts. And that's what you'd say about Roy Keane. That's what I think. Aidan would tell you that himself. It's like human beings. Some horses have got more guts and more determination, want to get there. If a horse comes up beside it, it gives more. You know, because they want to get over the winning line first. Roy would be the same.
Of the 130 horses currently trained by Aidan, 50% of them are either sired or bred at Coolmore. But at the peak of Vincent's career, breeding control rested with the Americans. Vincent and John Magna saw that the future lay in redressing this imbalance.
It may seem pretty tough on Irish breeders at the moment that the American horses are having such success here. I have no doubt that the Irish breeders will tackle the problem, and of course the way to do it is to buy back some of the blood that has been exported to America over the years.
Vincent O'Brien's purchase of Nijinsky in 1968 was to be the start of an historic era at Ballydoyle.
It was enormously important, slightly accidental on day one. I mean, it's an oft-told story, but my father went to Winfield's to see a horse by Rebo and just happened to see Nijinsky cantering around the field, ended up buying him. He was obviously the first Northern Dancer to end up in Europe because it was very rare for any American yearling to come back. And after him, he got his full brother, who was decent, and then he got a few more Northern Dancers and more success, and then all of a sudden everyone else was on the bandwagon and there were sons of Northern Dancer here. So, I mean, basically, he single-handedly established that bloodline.
With Northern Dancer's bloodline coursing through the veins of Coolmore's premier stallion, Sadler's Wells, he went on to sire more Group 1 winners than any other stallion in history.
I mean, you have to have a stallion like that, that basically keeps the whole place going. He is the standard bearer of the whole operation.
There are so many different levels of breeding. The small breeder will have to try and send his mares to whatever stallion he can afford and maybe hope that a miracle will happen and that he is able to, something will come out of the blue. Then when you're at the top level, it's another ball game, isn't it? You're breeding to the Storm Cats and the Sadler's Wells and all that.
With the top stallions commanding stud fees in the region of $500,000 and covering 100-plus mares, it's obvious that prize money becomes nearly insignificant and the real rewards are in the breeding sheds.
You know, there's the old story of breed the best to the best, or the best you can get, I'd say. That's the first thing to do. And then luck does have a lot to do with it, and environment. Very often, the good horses come from the same breeders. And very often the same people look after the good horses. You know, and Ireland has a lot of advantages in raising horses.
John Magner has put together an extremely high-class group of broodmares, and they use the very best stallions, and they produce some very nice horses. It's like being the manager of a football team. If you haven't got the right kit to play, you can be the best manager in the world, but you won't win the big trophies.
Aidan's obviously, he's a very, very talented trainer. He's an excellent horseman. Obviously, they buy very nice horses. But, you know, Aidan started off, made his name with National Hunt horses and probably very inexpensive horses, and was an instant success with those. One can see his results have improved year on year in the few years that he's been training flat horses. And, you know, I think this year, if you look at his results, you just have to say he's made very, very few, if any, mistakes.
Obviously, it is. It's great to nurse them along at two, and it's great when they do train on. From the time the mares are covered, the time the foals are born, the foals are weaned and got prepared for the sales, broken his yearling. It's a big team effort all the way.
Improving family here, Minardi out of the second.
All the horses that we buy, we sell them all at the end of the day again, with the exception of some that we keep as stallions. So, you know, when you breed horses, you have to take what God gives you. And at the sales, you know, you buy what you want. So it's the combination of the two.
Yeah, it is the business end of it, and it's fascinating. I mean, it's all geared towards success on the racecourse, and thereon, the success on the racecourse dictates the stallions and the stallion fees and what mares are worth and everything.
You've got to believe and be sure that you're doing the right thing, because it's a great deal of money, and you've got to be very, very aware of the amount of money. But obviously, I have to be very aware that I'm not playing with my own money here. I'm playing with somebody else's, and therefore one has to be very careful and make sure that one doesn't get overcome by the occasion.
Ultimately, everybody latches on to what appears to be the best horse. It's not always right. That's what makes this game so interesting. You know, a yearling that could cost 5,000 could beat the one that costs 5 million. You know, the horses don't know what they cost. You take somebody like Demi O'Byrne, he spends a lot of his time on the road going from one sale to the other and looking at horses from Australia, America, wherever. So, you know, that's a very specialist area. It's a gift, really, knowing which is which at the sales, and some people are better than others at it. The emphasis used to be on America, and I think there's a switch back to Europe now, because there's been huge investment over the last 20 years, and I would say that the European sales have taken over as being the most important in the world. The sales in Ireland are very important when you think of all the good horses that have been bred in Ireland, and they're becoming more important as the years go by. But Irish people are the real key, and wherever there are successful horse operations around the world, you tend to see Irish people in charge of them.
You can get them in from any country you like, but they have a natural ability, the Irish people. I don't know whether it is ingrained in them from the old plough horses long ago or what it is, but they seem to be horsemen and women.
With all the thoroughbreds in the world being descended from just three Arabian stallions, it's no surprise that the Arab-owned Godolphin stables are O'Brien's main rivals.
The standard of European racing has improved dramatically over the last 15, 20 years, because all of a sudden the best bred horses in the world are racing against each other here. And they have two very powerful operations in Godolphin and Ballydoyle now, and they are quite happy to take each other on. It makes it hard for the rest of us, but on the other hand, it's great viewing for the outsider.
Aidan O'Brien, he's a great trainer. We are very good friends, and always when we see each other, we talk about the horses and different subjects also. You know, he do have a good result since when he started. And in 99, we have 18 Group 1. It was the best season ever for us. Aidan O'Brien, he do very good, result this year, and he have a great chance also in America.
How important is it to you to win in America?
Very important.
With European trainers increasingly turning their sights to America, Giants Causeway came heartbreakingly close to providing Aidan with his first American win. But the twin lures of prestige and shrewd business acumen meant he'd be back for more.
When you're standing a horse and he's just raced exclusively on the turf, he's attractive to European breeders. If you can go and be successful on the dirt, you immediately bring the American element in. You take a horse like Giants Causeway, for example, it's no secret that he got a number of mares from America on what he's achieved. And if you're standing a horse for a large sum of money, there's a limit to the amount of people in Europe who can pay those fees.
I suppose if you have a lot of top-class horses, there's not room for them. There are only a few classics here and in England, and France maybe. I'd say America, here I come from this house, yeah.
This is WSCA-FM, New York's finest radio station, and we're at Belmont Park for the Breeders' Cup, the Thoroughbred Championship of the World. Bob Baffert reckons he has a real superstar in Officer, and it looks like it's going to be Officer first, and the rest nowhere in the juvenile. Other news is that the Irish are back for more. Young Irish trainer Aidan O'Brien certainly trying to do it his way, arriving so late, and it looks as if O'Brien's best shot will be on the turf, as it's 10 years since a European win of any kind on the dirt here at the Belmonts.
There are a lot of important factors that go into a victory in the Breeders' Cup.
It's obviously a world championship day, and you have horses come from all over the place that are ready to run their best, and you have certainly have to be at your best on that day.
Aidan O'Brien's horses flew in here on Tuesday evening, and as soon as they touched down, bloods were taken off the horses and were sent by Learjet to the University of Ames in Iowa. The situation with Aidan's horses are, though, that they've not taken their CEM swabs, so they are here on a racing waiver. They're kept in the quarantine barn, and although they're allowed to go out and train, they can't mix with the local horse population except on the race day, obviously.
I was really happy with their outlook this morning, and they seemed happy and content, and they seem to be eating very well in there now. Not too many worries so far anyway, not until tomorrow afternoon anyway.
They have great horses and good trainers and good jockeys. It's not that problem. They take the worst of it, really. If we were to take the same group of horses and run them at the Coeur or someplace, we're going to have the disadvantage. Their shipping usually is right on top of the race. They usually go into a surface that they're not familiar with. They go into track configurations they're not familiar with.
Well, I guess it's hard to say. I'm sure that they have a better handle on how they perform over these dirt surfaces compared to the grass. And nobody's as successful as Aidan O'Brien without really knowing their horses, and what they did last year with Giants Causeway, certainly have to give them a lot of respect.
They not only have to adjust to the footing, they also have to adjust to the kickback in the face. Although a horse has a very unique eye and can tolerate and can see through the sand when his eye is covered, I think that at time the vision may be blurred slightly, and if they're in real tight quarters at the same time that the vision is blurred, I think it hinders their chances as well.
I think international racing is great for everybody. It brings all the farm lines together, and everybody can get a handle on the horses, and everybody finds out together what horse suits what races, and it's experience.
Aidan who? Just kidding, Aidan! Oh, he's wonderful. Absolutely unbelievable that the accomplishments that he's achieved at this early part of his life.
I find him very refreshing. He has no ego whatsoever. He's very open. I'm very open with him. It's easy for me to be open with him and to give him any help that I may, simply because I don't have to compete against him but once a year.
I've met him once, very nice guy, sort of quiet guy, I need to spice it up a little bit, David, what was that stuff, that chili red? What was that stuff that the cayenne pepper stuff? Panama red, sprinkle that on his testicles, get him going. He'll come up with some good stuff.
I think the European horses that are in tomorrow are very talented, obviously. I know Johannesburg is a very nice colt. He's never been beyond seven, I believe. And so for him to stretch a little bit further is going to be a challenge.
There's an exceptional colt here called Officer, and if he's as good as they say, we'd probably be in his wake. But Johannesburg, I'd be happy. I think he's going to run a good race. It's just a question of, it's a mile and a 16, whether he has the stamina just to run it out.
Officer, he's we refer to him as a superstar. I'm coming in here with a superstar. I don't know how good he's going to be like next year, but for a two-year-old, he's pretty wicked. And if we get the right trip, I just can't see him getting beat. To me, Irish, English, they're all the same to me. I don't know what, I know Galileo, Johannesburg. He looks like he's a dirt horse, been running on grass, so I don't know about him at all.
Well, last year, previous, was a bit of a disappointment with Giants Causeway to come so close. And we felt going, if we could get a result, it would be a great achievement. It's so difficult, but it was important for everybody. To dominate Europe this season was one thing, but it was important to put a marker in America and show that we could come and do it. And that's what made it really satisfying.
Well, coming up will be the Breeders' Cup Juvenile, and we talked about favorites and how they've fared today. I wonder what Bob Baffert is thinking right now. He trains Officer, who opens up as the 4-5 favorite on the morning line, the lowest-priced favorite of the day.
Well, Tom,
Tom, when you talk two-year-olds this year, you're talking officer. He is the man when it comes to these two-year-olds. And if he goes on and wins here this afternoon, you know, people are going to start talking about him in the same breath as, dare I say, Secretariat. There's Johannesburg, and never been on the dirt, never been past six furlongs, but he's also never lost a race. Anytime they haven't lost, you got to respect him, Bob. But, you know, Officer has, like you said, he's been in a class by himself, and, you know, unless he gets stuck down along the rail, doesn't run his race, I just don't see him losing here.
Now we're ready for that start. And they're off.
I think it'll be very hard for any horse to equal that feat. Four group ones in four different countries. It's a fantastic achievement. We started at Ferry House, ended up at the Breeders' Cup. It's a long road, and to coach a two-year-old through all that and end up at the very end of the season for his best performance, I think it was a great training performance by him.
Officer has been head-to-head with Came Home the entire way. French Assault on the outside. They've run three quarters in 111 flat.
I felt there was going to be pace on, and I felt that Officer wouldn't get an easy lead. And my plan was to slot in behind them and see how they were going and get his toe as long as possible. I was able to sit and wait as long as I wanted to, and he quickened really well in his finish.
Comes the European champion, Johannesburg. He's charging hard. The defense is coming fast too. It is Johannesburg. The defense, I thought it. Johannesburg has won it. Undefeated. And now a champion on two continents. Johannesburg has won. Repent, and finishing third was Siphonic. He ran away from the best in Europe, and he runs away from America's best today. Johannesburg, the winner. All right, Tom, score one for Europe as the best two-year-old in Europe beats the best North American two-year-old in Officer, now the champion two-year-old in all the world. The first Breeders' Cup victory for Mick Canaan, the champion Irish jockey, and for Aidan O'Brien, the young trainer from Ballydoyle, who's had such an unbelievable season.
I'm here with Mick Canaan. Mick, you had some bad luck last year. This looks like it makes up for it. What a wonderful horse.
Yeah, he's been a champion every step of the way through the year.
We've had a few dry runs here with some decent horses, and this year we brought the best we could bring. And Michael Tabor and John Magner, they're great supporters, and this is what they wanted, and I'm really happy for them, you know. They're looking for the next stallion, the next champion, and they need to get him, and it's great that they got one this year. Yeah,
Mick, for everybody who's cheering you home in Ireland, well done.
Thank you
very much.
He ran a great race, travelled great, quickened really well. He's a serious colt. Michael gave him a super ride, and
especially after last year, that so close and so far.
Exactly, yeah, so everything went great, and he did a great on the day.
We're all delighted for you. Yep. Thanks very much, Aidan.
Thank you, my pleasure. Thank you.
We're running out of breath.
Oh, you better believe it. They come here loaded for bear. Everybody's impressed. Obviously, he retained his form. He came here as a good horse, and he's leaving as a good horse. He's the best two-year-old in the world.
Aidan O'Brien has finally got one in the bag. Will you come back for more?
There's an old saying, does Dolly Parton sleep on her back? You know who Dolly Parton is?
Winning turf races is obviously tremendous for European horses, but when you do it to the Americans on the dirt, then they've nowhere to hide.
Well, I think they'll be staggered. I think there's a natural formality here, and that is that whenever the Europeans come over, they just put a line through them every time. But I think Aidan O'Brien today has come up trumps with Johannesburg, which must rate as one of the great training performances of the modern era.
It would be fantastic if you had the same surface in America, in Europe, in Japan, so horses could move around more freely. And I think it will happen. It's just a matter of when. You could have a situation where you could have the Breeders' Cup or the World Championship at the end of the year. Maybe one year it could come to Europe and the other year it could be back in America.
The great thing is, it's probably going to get better. You know, because experience will add to what he's got just now.
This is a man who understands horses in the way only a horseman can. And there have been a few trainers down the years that can do that, that are brave enough to buck a trend, to do something completely different. And he is definitely in that category.
At the same time, next week here on One, you can see a profile on Kathleen O'Neill. Economics is the name of the game after the break, though, as we join George Lee for more to do.